this morning is multi-talented, multifaceted. She's versatile. I met her, what, about 20 years ago? I think before I started coming to the temple, I came here and saw her. I would consider her not only my fellow practitioner, but my friend. She is a teacher, she's a jeweler, she is a wonderful spiritual light. I give to you Mrs. Carol Campbell.
Thank you. She deserves a hug up for that intro. Good morning, my temple family. Let me add my own words of welcome, and a special welcome to those who are joining us on the World Wide Web. This is a beautiful day, isn't it? I recently overheard a conversation while I stood in my backyard. This came from behind the wall on the street. Look here, man. Death are the best part of life. Say what? Now my ears prick up. Me said death are the best part of life. How you figure? You know I'm go to heaven. Yes, but then how you figure go to heaven if you're not dead? Translation. How do you expect to get to heaven if you don't die? That's a serious question. And the larger question, which holds the answer, is what and where is heaven really? And what does it have to do with me? Many of us who are brought up in Orthodox Church, of whichever denomination, were taught to believe in a far-off heaven ruled by a vengeful and capricious God who would grant us entry only if we were good and well-behaved. I think a few of us, including myself, decided at that point that maybe the heat downstairs wasn't so bad after all. And yes, sweat was good for the complexion. What a relief to come to this teaching and hear that sin is simply a mistake, an archer's term for missing the mark. And there is no one keeping score to punish us for our sins. We suffer the consequences of our own faulty thinking and are punished by our mistakes. You remember a movie from the 1940s called Heaven Can Wait? No? Yes, you're too young. It was about a wealthy aristocratic playboy who had a rather wayward way with the ladies and broke many hearts. Well, he dies after a long and eventful life and shows up at the gates of hell, feeling guilty and very contrite, convinced that that's where he belonged. The chief, however, advised him to review his life and perhaps seek entrance upstairs, since he did more good than harm during his life and was basically a good person. With that in mind, I've titled my talk this morning, Knocking on Heaven's Door. Our Declaration of Principles states, we believe that heaven is within us, and we experience it to the degree that we become conscious of it. And further, we believe the ultimate goal of life to be a complete emancipation from all discord of every nature, and that this goal is sure to be attained by all. The Bible is full of references to heaven in both the Old and New Testaments, and it is always in the context of the restoration of our inherent original perfection, always the journey of generic man from paradise to paradise, as it were, the story of the process through which people go in their ignorance and having to learn by experience the way back to the state of Eden, a state of wholeness and perfection, of oneness with the source, which is God. The Bible, which really is a story within a story, really is our story, told in a variety of ways through a variety of characters and situations designed to teach us about ourselves. It begins in Genesis, with Adam and Eve created in the image and likeness of perfection in the paradise, the Garden of Eden, and ends with the return to paradise as man awakens to the perfection of his own being through spiritual rebirth as recounted in Revelation. Revelation 21 reads, "And I saw a new heaven, heaven within, and a new earth without. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea." The sea refers to a state of consciousness. So the former consciousness had passed away. "And he that sat upon the throne," now that is the God self within that has dominion, "said, Behold, I make all things new." In his book, The Hidden Mystery of the Bible, Jack Addington says, and I quote, "Heaven is the divine consciousness within, the realm of divine ideas, the conscious awareness of God, bliss, divine harmony realized." Now, who wouldn't want to have that as a here and now experience? Wouldn't you? In Matthew, I'm using the Bible very heavily this morning with a metaphysical interpretation to it. In Matthew chapter 3, verses 16 and 17, we're told that following Jesus' baptism by John the Baptist, the heavens were opened upon him, the Spirit of God descended, and a voice from heaven declared, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." I think many of us tend to equate Jesus with Superman, you know? And this booming voice comes out of the clouds and says, "You are my beloved." Now, this is my interpretation. That's some pretty heavy stuff to deal with, remembering that God is within. At this baptism, the baptism represents a cleansing, a refreshing of the Spirit. And this intelligence within Jesus himself allows him to realize that he is the one. Now, that can be a bit overwhelming. It says that he immediately went into the wilderness. Wilderness, in metaphysical terms, represents unenlightened thought. That says it could be a little bit confusing, overwhelming. Oh my God, this is my mission. Now, he spent 40 days and 40 nights in the wilderness, in the state of unenlightenment, during which time he was sorely tempted by the devil. The devil is nothing more than our own ego thoughts. So here he is now, having come to the full realization of what his mission is. He could probably get a little ego kick, you know? I'm the greatest, you know? And it's okay, so I'm hungry. Okay, if you're so great, then turn these stones into bread. And for 40 days and 40 nights, he has this ego thing going on. The 40 days and 40 nights is also very significant. It represents a stage of spiritual growth. And 40 is the completion of spiritual unfoldment. So at the end of this 40 days and 40 nights, he says, "Hold on a minute. Stop this. Get thee behind me, Satan. Stop this. This is not what it's about. This is not my mission." And he emerges from that experience and begins to teach and preach, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Now, having seen firsthand some charismatic preachers bearing down on their congregations with the exhortation to repent, I think maybe a little clarification regarding repentance is appropriate here. To repent very simply means to rethink, to change your mind. It's not about guilt or remorse. It's about gaining a new perspective, an enlightened vision. You can see why Jesus would suggest this was a good practice. One of the basic tenets of the science of mind, which you'll hear often, is change your thinking, change your life. Heaven is a very present experience when we tune in to divine ideas and deliberately, consciously decide to make bliss and divine harmony real in our experience. That's not something anybody else can do for us. The kingdom of heaven is at hand, right where we are, not separate from us in some far-off realm of space. Heaven exists in our own consciousness, and we experience it to the degree that we are consciously aware of that truth. Heaven is not a geographical location. There is nothing that can replace the right mindset. There is nothing more powerful than our focused intention to experience heaven right where we are. The only thing that needs to die is the old way of thinking and being. When we set a new paradigm in motion, new results must inevitably appear. When I speak about a paradigm, I simply mean a great collection of ingrained habits that become a way of being. So a paradigm shift requires nurturing new ideas that become new habits that will support some new behaviors and consequently produce some new results. So we don't have to go anywhere to get to heaven, and we certainly don't need to physically die, but we do need to think in a new way. We can experience heaven, or hell too for that matter, every day, several times a day if we want to. There are so many versions of heaven, and they all speak to a state of being where all seems right with the world of our experience. For instance, I was in heaven recently when I attended the Calabash Literary Festival in Treasure Beach. Just to be immersed in the beauty of the surroundings and the beauty of the language with all its color and nuances, to have the words swirl around me in infinite variety with passion and power. Now, that might not be your idea of heaven, and that's okay. What made it a heavenly experience? Not the external stuff. Heaven is more than our external experience of good, because it begins inside our own mind. Heaven is an inside job, and there isn't only one heaven. The experience of it is as individual as we are. Let's try a little exercise. I want you to close your eyes. And just for a moment, think about a time, real or imagined, where you felt blissfully happy. It can be a childhood memory, a fantasy, or something that happened yesterday or this morning. It doesn't matter. It's your experience. Immerse yourself in it. See it in technicolor. Hear it in surround sound. Allow yourself to really feel the feeling. Breathe it in. Revel in it. Smile at the deliciousness of it. Isn't it heavenly? Okay, you can come back now. You can go back at any time you choose. Of course, the same holds true for hell. Every time you dredge up those old hurts and angers and disappointments, you're putting yourself right back in that hellhole. Your body doesn't know the difference between the real, the imagined, or the remembered. So the more vivid the experience in your mind, the body responds appropriately and releases feel-good chemicals when you feel happy and search and destroy chemicals when you feel hateful and angry. We need to remember that. Dr. Ernest Holmes, the founder of this teaching known as the Science of Mind, writing in his book, How to Use the Science of Mind, says, and I quote, "We should think of our lives as an increasing awareness, an ever-growing and expanding consciousness, a never-ceasing progress of individual and collective evolution. There should be a constant joy in expansion, an enthusiastic sense of adventure. It is enough to know that our good is with us today, that tomorrow this same good can be multiplied, and so on forever." End quote. We exist as part of an infinite universe. Therefore, there is no past to regret, no future to fear, only the present moment to experience. And we're called to do the best we can with what we have in the only time we have, now. So what can we do to ensure a safe passage to heaven? Going back to the Bible, in Matthew chapter 5, we're treated to the Beatitudes. I like to call them the Beatitudes. It's a good place to start. I won't go through all of them, just those that directly mention heaven. Verse 1, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. That doesn't mean you must be a wimp. It means you must be more willing and less willful. Verse 10, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Righteousness refers to the right use of the universal law of cause and effect. My mom used to say, do good and good follow you. Verse 16, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Now light refers to clarity, wisdom, and truth. It is a synonym for God. So let your life demonstrate the divine intelligence working in you so that all may understand that they too have access to divine illumination. Verse 18, for verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. There is a law of life which is unchangeable, dependable, constant, and orderly. It is the way God works through its creations, which include you and me. What you sow, you reap. Verse 19, but whosoever shall do and teach these commandments, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Now, bearing in mind that the kingdom of heaven is within, these are not so much commandments as agreements we make with ourselves to live from a higher purpose. And finally, verse 48. Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. Infinite goodness and perfection are already within us, awaiting our recognition of it, so that it may demonstrate itself through us. And that's where you would like to be. That is how you access heaven. Wouldn't you agree that how we live now is far more important than how we may die later? Life is for living. There is one life which is infinitely varied in its expression and possibilities. I'd like you to say with me a treatment written by Dr. Holmes, found in his book, How to Use the Science of Mind. I'll read it and then you can repeat it with me. Today, I bestow the essence of love upon everything.
Today, I bestow the essence of love upon everything.
I know that this love essence, the very substance of life, the creative principle back of everything,
flows through my whole being.
Spiritual, emotional, mental, and physical. It flows in transcendent loveliness. Into my world of thought and form. Ever renewing, vitalizing.
Bringing joy and harmony and blessing
to everything and everyone it touches. And so it is. There is nothing we can't do or be. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. Now you notice he didn't say, in my Father's house, there are many rooms. The idea of a mansion speaks to great, expansive, lavish existence. This is what awaits us at the Father's house, but we have to reclaim our rightful place by first recognizing from whence we came. We came from God, our true source, and then letting the will of God, the Father, which is always for our highest good, be realized on earth, our outer experience, as it is in heaven, our inner conscious awareness. For thine is the kingdom, our heavenly experience of blissful harmony, which is within us. The power, that deep inner clarity of big T truth, and the glory, the fulfillment that comes from complete trust in the law, forever and ever,
ad infinitum. Let the church say, amen.
Amen.
Namaste.